piloted aircraft, like the army uses or the defense uses it for surveillance. They are also used in snowmobiles, for example, when you want to work at extremely low temperatures. It's a two-stroke engine which can work because of the simple lubrication system that it has got. We know that they are also used in small gensets, then in water scooters, then also in marine outboard motors. For example, the speed boats or the recreational boats, all of them use two-stroke engines. They are multi-cylinder two-stroke engines. On the other side, we also have two-stroke engines that are very large, like the large marine diesel engines. The diesel engines which power big ships, they are all two-stroke engines. And so you have two-stroke engines on two ends, the small engines and the very large engines. These very large engines are really large. For example, the bore and stroke of a really large engine could be something like, the bore could be about 1.5 meters, and the stroke could be some 2.5 meters. So something like that. They are also two-stroke engines. And on the other hand, you can also have toy planes and cars, like toy plane engines, where the bore could be just about 1 centimeter. The stroke could be less than 1 centimeter. So you have two ends. But these two ends of the two-stroke engine are not similar. The small engines are all spark ignition engines. The large engines are all diesel engines. We also have two-stroke engines in, for example, the sprayers and things like that, where the user mounts the engine on his back and uses a sprayer to spray pesticides. So they are also used two-stroke engines. So there are many applications where two-stroke engines are used. And if you see, only one of these, which is scooters and motorcycles, is an automotive application. All the others are non-automotive applications. So what we can see from here is that the two-stroke engines will be there in all these applications. They may go in automotive applications, not too in the bigger automotive applications like motorcycles and scooters, but they'll still stay in mopeds and they stay in all the other applications. So it is useful to study about the two-stroke engine because there's a lot that can be done to improve a two-stroke engine. So coming to the I know that you all know how a two-stroke engine works, so I'm not going to dwell upon this for a very long time. If you look at the working of a two-stroke engine, you know that the top and the bottom portions of the engine are being used. For example, you will use the top portion, which we call as the combustion chamber, and you also use the bottom portion, which is called as the crankcase. So both the top and the bottom portion of the engine will be used. And the air-fuel mixture actually gets into the bottom portion. It gets into the bottom portion, and then it is supplied to the top portion through the ports. So we call a two-stroke engine as a double-acting engine. So both the top and bottom portions of the engine are used, and this
the
makes
the slides are not very clear. The slide is not fully visible. This slide, yes, you will have to move it.
This slide.
So move it a little bit so that it is clearly visible. This.
Oh, I think it's not in the center of the screen.
Now it is okay. Now it is okay.
So shall we continue? So we'll continue now.
Yeah.
So in the two-stroke engine, as we saw, both the top and bottom sides are used. So it's a double-acting engine. And so we see that the engine is compact. So as you do something on the top of the piston, you do something else at the bottom of the piston. For example, if you are doing compression on the top of the piston, you are doing suction at the bottom of the piston. So four strokes of a four-stroke engine come in two strokes of a two-stroke engine. So every revolution we get a power stroke. And the point to note here is that the fresh fuel air mixture gets into the intake, which may be controlled by a valve, which may be controlled by the piston, goes into the crankcase, and then from the crankcase it is pumped into the cylinder, or the top portion of the piston, where it undergoes combustion and all that. So there is a big path through which the mixture has to travel in a two-stroke engine. It has to go to the crankcase and then come to the top. This is what you see here. Now we'll proceed further and see certain important terms related to two-stroke engine. The first term which is related to two-stroke engine is called scavenging. Now what is called a scavenging? Now in a two-stroke engine, the fresh charge that comes from the bottom has to first enter and push the exhaust out. So what we do is, the exhaust port, as you see here, and the piston moves down, first opens, and when the exhaust port opens, the exhaust gases rush out, and the fresh charge then comes inside when the transfer port opens. So we call this port as a transfer port, and this port as an exhaust port. So the fresh charge comes through the transfer port, and pushes the exhaust out through the exhaust port. So during this process, we see what is called as scavenging. So the process of filling the cylinder with fresh charge is called scavenging. So during the scavenging process, several things happen. The first thing which happens is the exhaust goes out. And this goes out because of the pressure difference. And there is a pressure difference between the gas inside the cylinder and the atmosphere. So when the exhaust port opens, the exhaust gases rush out. And we call this as blowdown. We call this as a blowdown process. And after that, the exhaust does not go out on its own because the pressure inside the cylinder falls. And then the fresh charge which comes from the bottom pushes the exhaust out. And we see fresh charge pushing the exhaust. So these two processes are called scavenging. So the exhaust going out on its own and the fresh charge coming behind the exhaust and pushing the exhaust out, these two processes together are called scavenging. And during this process, what we actually want is to fill the cylinder with fresh charge and not lose any fresh charge. We want to fill the cylinder with fresh charge and we do not want to lose any fresh charge. This is what we want to have. So this is what we call as good scavenging. Now good scavenging is got by a proper design of the ports. Now we have another problem called charge dilution. So if you look at the cylinder contents after the scavenging is done, you will not only have fresh charge but also exhaust. And we call this exhaust as a residual exhaust. So the charge is diluted. So we have what is called as a diluted charge. So this diluted charge does not burn properly. So you need to have a mixture which is rich. So we need to have a rich mixture. For combustion. So the point I want to make here is that during the scavenging process, you may not fully remove all the exhaust from the cylinder. So some exhaust will be retained in the cylinder. And this retained exhaust will mix with the fresh charge and you have what is called as a diluted fresh charge. And this diluted fresh charge does not burn well. And this diluted fresh charge, if it has to burn well, you have to use a rich mixture. And when I say rich mixture, it could be even richer than stoichiometric. Now if you look at gasoline, the stoichiometric air fuel ratio would be something like 14.5:1. This air is to fuel. It will be about 14.5:1 for gasoline. But in the case of a two-stroke engine, we may want to go very rich. We may even go up to about 12:1. That is 12 parts of air for one part of fuel. Instead of 14.5 parts of air for one part of fuel, that means you are going to run the engine rich. And if you do not run the engine rich, we will not be able to support combustion in a diluted environment. This is one of the problems in a two-stroke engine. So we now saw scavenging. We also saw charge dilution. So, and charge dilution is a result of poor scavenging. So if you have very good scavenging, you will not have charge dilution. All the exhaust would have gone out and the fresh charge would have been retained inside. We also have another problem which is called as short circuiting. Short circuiting is bypassing of the fresh charge. So the fresh charge which comes into the cylinder simply bypasses. So what you do is if you have this cylinder and if you allow fresh charge, the exhaust is supposed to go out of the cylinder, but what happens is some of this fresh charge also goes out. So this we call as short circuiting of the fresh charge, which means that if you put some fuel into the engine, some of the fuel is directly going to go out through the exhaust port. So this brings in another problem, and this problem means that the efficiency, which I'll use the symbol eta for efficiency, efficiency thermal is low because we lose fuel. So fuel is lost through the exhaust port. Since fuel is lost through the exhaust port, your efficiency in a two-stroke engine is going to be low. So we saw different problems in a two-stroke engine. The first one was the scavenging related problems. The first one was charge dilution. That is, you retain some exhaust gases which did not allow the fresh charge to burn. And you also lost some fresh charge which went out through the exhaust, which meant that you lost some fuel. So these are the two problems in a two-stroke engine. And those two problems mean that the performance of a two-stroke engine will be poor. It will not be as good as a four-stroke engine. Now, we have several terms which we come across in a two-stroke engine. I will define these terms because we will use these terms very frequently. Now, looking at scavenging, we need to define these terms. The first term which we define is called delivery ratio. Delivery ratio is something like volumetric efficiency. It is something like volumetric efficiency of a four-stroke engine. It is actually written as mass delivered by reference mass. This is what we call as delivery ratio. That is, in a two-stroke engine, the mass of fresh fuel air mixture that is actually delivered to the engine divided by the ideal mass that you should have delivered, that you should have delivered. This mass that you actually deliver is actually measured. This you can measure. The reference mass is what you should have delivered under ideal conditions. What we should have delivered under ideal conditions is the displacement volume multiplied by a density. That is, you should have put displacement volume amount of charge into the cylinder, and you should have put it at the density of the charge. And for density, I'll use ambient density. So you are taking charge from the atmosphere. So the relevant density, in fact, sometimes people use even the density of the air fuel mixture. But many times in textbooks, we refer to density of the ambient itself. So we should be able to fill the cylinder with charge which is at ambient density, and the volume that you should be able to put into the cylinder is the displacement volume. That becomes the denominator. And what comes on the numerator is what you actually deliver. In a four-stroke engine, this same term is called volumetric efficiency. In a two-stroke engine, we call it delivery ratio. Now, the delivery ratio in a two-stroke engine is extremely low. In fact, the maximum delivery ratio, L max, will be about 0.7 to 0.8 only. It will be only about 0.7 to 0.8. That means you are going to deliver only 80% of the charge that you could have ideally delivered, which itself means that you are not fully filling the cylinder properly. That means there will be some space which will be occupied by exhaust gases. So this is the first term. If you have a higher delivery ratio, which it automatically means that you will have higher power outputs. You put more fresh charge, and you will also be able to drive the exhaust properly. So higher delivery ratios are preferred. The next term that we come across is scavenging efficiency. Scavenging efficiency is how well you have pushed the exhaust out. Now, efficiency scavenging is nothing but the mass of fresh charge that is retained. You send some fresh charge into the cylinder. Some of it was retained, some of it went out. The mass that was retained is put on the numerator, and total cylinder mass is put on the denominator. That is, you have full cylinder. This full cylinder contains some mass, out of which what is the fresh charge mass that you retained is the numerator. So this is called as scavenging efficiency. So this is another term which we come across in two-stroke engines. If the scavenging efficiency is good, that means inside the cylinder you have mostly fresh charge. If the scavenging efficiency is bad, it means that inside the cylinder you have a lot of exhaust. So this is another term which is important. Another term which is important is called trapping efficiency. It is the mass of the fresh charge that is retained by mass delivered. That is, you have fresh charge inside the cylinder. You send some fresh charge into the cylinder from the crankcase, and some of it has been retained, and that comes on the numerator. And on the denominator, you put what has been delivered. So what does this signify? If this value is very high, it means that whatever you have supplied is retained. Suppose this value becomes 1, then it means that mass retained and mass supplied are, mass delivered are the same. So if mass retained and mass delivered are the same, that means nothing was short-circuited. So this gives an indication of short-circuiting efficiency. If this value is high, it means there is no short-circuit. So scavenging efficiency is high means you have very pure charge inside. That is, you have more of the retained charge in the total mass of the charge. If trapping efficiency is high means you do not lose any charge through the exhaust port. So both the scavenging efficiency and trapping efficiency have to be high for a two-stroke engine. Is it clear? This is what we write from here. Purity is like scavenging efficiency. It tells how pure your charge is. Now let us look at the next aspect of effective storage. I am slowly giving you some introduction. Later on, we'll put these things together. Now this is the PV diagram of a two-stroke engine. If you look at the left-hand side, you have the PV diagram of a two-stroke engine. On the right-hand side, you have the PV diagram of a four-stroke engine. You have already been exposed to PV diagrams. Now if you look at the two-stroke engine, the thing which is to be noted here is that you don't have the so-called pumping loop. This loop is called the pumping loop in a four-stroke engine, where you do the suction and exhaust strokes. During the suction stroke, the pressure in the cylinder is below atmospheric pressure. During the exhaust stroke, the pressure in the cylinder is above atmospheric pressure, and that's why you got that loop. Whereas in a two-stroke engine, you don't have that loop at all. In a two-stroke engine, you just have the pressure diagram only on the cylinder side. You have another pressure diagram on the crankcase side. So these two pressure diagrams are different, and what has been shown here is only on the cylinder side. So on the cylinder side, if I have to trace this pressure diagram, this is the expansion process. We'll go from the expansion. So the piston is moving down. The piston is moving down from the top dead center to the bottom dead center. Expansion occurs, and at some point, the exhaust port opens. So if you have to go to the previous figure, which we first saw, as the piston moves from the top dead center to the bottom dead center, the exhaust port opens at some point. And when the exhaust port opens, the exhaust gases will rush out, and the pressure in the cylinder will suddenly fall. And this we call as the blowdown process, which is what is shown here. So at this exhaust port opening point, the pressure suddenly falls, because when the exhaust port opens, the gases rush out. And the pressure falls, and after some time, the inlet port opens. And when the inlet port opens, the fresh charge from the crankcase will start entering into the cylinder. So between this exhaust opening point and inlet opening point, we call this as blowdown. So this is a phase where the exhaust opens. I'm sorry, this is continuously shifting. I'm not able to stop. So when the exhaust port opens, there's a rush of exhaust from the cylinder, pressure falls, and then after some time, the pressure becomes equal to crankcase pressure, and that time the inlet port opens. And when the inlet port opens, the fresh charge from the crankcase comes into the cylinder. So this is inlet port opening, this is exhaust port opening, and the piston again closes the inlet port at this point and closes the exhaust port at this point. So when the piston moves down, it first opens the exhaust port. When it moves further, it opens the intake port. It goes to bottom dead center. When it comes up, it first closes the intake port and then closes the exhaust port. So that's what we see here. Exhaust opens, inlet closes, exhaust closes. And actual compression actually starts here. Compression actually starts at this point. So it is only here that we start compressing. The point I want to make here is, in a four-stroke engine, we start compressing right from bottom dead center. In a two-stroke engine, we do not start compressing from bottom dead center. We can start compressing only after the exhaust port is closed, which means that the compression starts here and ends at top dead center. So this I will call as the effective compression stroke. So you're not really compressing from bottom dead center. So the effective compression stroke is smaller than the actual stroke. The actual stroke is from BDC to TDC, but the compression stroke effectively is from exhaust port closing to top dead center, which is smaller. Similarly, the actual expansion stroke is also smaller. So this is actual expansion and compression stroke. So this is the actual expansion and compression stroke. This means that the engine is not going to expand your gases fully. It's only partly expanding the gases. So this also means that the efficiency of a two-stroke engine will be low. So you can say now that the compression ratio of a two-stroke will be lower than the compression ratio geometry. That is a geometry compression ratio. What do you mean by geometry compression ratio? It is volume at BDC by volume at TDC. The volume at BDC divided by volume at TDC is the compression ratio. But that is not the compression ratio in a two-stroke engine. It is different because compression starts only at the exhaust port closing point. It doesn't start from bottom dead center. So the volume at BDC is equivalent to volume at exhaust port closing point, which means that the effective compression ratio in a two-stroke engine will be less than the geometric compression ratio. And this means that the efficiency of a two-stroke engine thermodynamically itself will be lower. So if you take a two-stroke engine whose compression ratio is something like 8 geometric, its actual compression ratio may be only about 7 or 6, which means that the engine would automatically develop lesser efficiencies. So this is one point to note. Now, this summarizes the whole thing. Now, we see the four timing diagram of a two-stroke engine. The piston is at top dead center. Now, let us trace from the point where the piston is at top dead center. The piston moves from top dead center to the bottom dead center. And at some point, when it moves down, the exhaust port opens. So, we see EVO. EVO is exhaust port opening point. TVO is transfer port opening point. Transfer port is the same as inlet port. Inlet port and transfer port are the same. So when the transfer port opens, you have fresh charge coming inside. When the exhaust port opens, you have high pressure gases going out. So this region is called blowdown. So after this blowdown, you have inlet occurring, and inlet starts from here and ends up to transfer port closing point. So this is the region, this is the time during which you can have fresh charge coming from the crankcase into the cylinder. After this, the transfer port first closes, because the piston closes the transfer port first, and then the exhaust port closes. And this is a region which is something which you do not want. You do not want the transfer port to, this region between the exhaust port closing and transfer port closing is something which you do not want, because when the transfer port closes, if the piston is moving up to close the exhaust port, whatever charge was taken into the cylinder would go out. So we do not want the exhaust port to close after the transfer port. We would like the exhaust port and the transfer port to close exactly the same point, or maybe we even want to close the exhaust port before the transfer port closes. But this is not possible in a normal two-stroke engine because of the piston being used for closing and opening the ports. So this is a defect in a two-stroke engine. And this defect occurs only in small two-stroke engines. It doesn't occur in big two-stroke engines where you can have valves. So in small two-stroke engines, there's a problem. So the problem is that you are not able to close the port early. Now the other problem is, if you look at the inlet opening, this is what happens at the bottom of the cylinder. So when the piston moves up, the bottom portion of the piston opens a crankcase, and fresh air from the atmosphere gets into the crankcase. And that is opened when the piston moves almost near top dead center. So the inlet port opens somewhere here and closes almost at the same time after top dead center. So this is the region where the fresh charge can enter into the crankcase. So in this portion, the fresh charge can enter into the crankcase, and you can see here that when the piston moves from bottom dead center to top dead center, below the crankcase, the volume will be increasing. So in this region, volume is increasing, but in this region, volume is decreasing. So when volume is decreasing, whatever has been taken into the crankcase could also be pushed out. So this is a region which you do not want. This is the region which you want. But if you want to use the piston to open and close the port, you have to have both the regions. So this is another problem in the two-stroke engine. If you push this inlet opening earlier and earlier, if you move this earlier and earlier, the inlet closing also will move later and later. So whatever you have taken in may be pushed out to the crankcase itself. So this is another problem in the two-stroke engine. So we see number of problems in the two-stroke engine, all because of the fact that piston is used to open and close the ports. And piston only is used to open and close the ports because it is the simplest way of doing things. So in a small two-stroke engine, because the piston is used to open and close the intake ports, we run into several problems. The first problem being that you're not able to close the exhaust port before the transfer port. The second problem is that you're not able to open the inlet port very early and then close the inlet port early. If you open the inlet port at some angle, you're also closing the inlet port at the same angle. This again becomes another problem. So these problems are there. And what I want to say here is that one of the problems, another problem with the two-stroke engine is high noise. If you just observe, if there is a two-stroke engine without a silencer, it makes much more noise than a four-stroke engine without a silencer. It even makes much more noise than a tractor engine without a silencer. The reason is, when the two-stroke engine opens its exhaust port, the pressure in the cylinder is fairly high. This is what we saw here. When the exhaust port is opened, the pressure in the cylinder in a two-stroke engine is fairly high, because you're opening the exhaust port fairly early. You're not opening it bottom dead center. You're opening it much before bottom dead center. So the pressure is very high. So when the exhaust port is opened, the hot gases inside the cylinder, which are at high pressure, just rush out, and it's almost like a small explosion. So pressure is about 5 bar, and at that time you simply open the exhaust port. So it just expands into the atmosphere and makes a lot of noise. So another problem in the two-stroke engine is high noise, and that occurs just because you open the exhaust port too early and you are forced to open it, otherwise the engine will not run properly. So this is another problem in the two-stroke engine. So there are several problems which you have seen: short circuiting, charge dilution, noise, not being able to take a lot of charge inside a cylinder. These are some of the important problems of a two-stroke engine. But still the two-stroke engine is popular because it is simple. That's the only reason. Now there are different methods by which one can admit the charge into a two-stroke engine. One method is called the rotary valve method. Now in the rotary valve method, you use a valve which is something like this. It is a disc-shaped valve with a slot, something like this. You have a disc which is shaped like this. You have a disc which is shaped like this, and this disc is actually something like this. I am drawing the other view of the disc. The slot is here. The slot is here. This is the full portion, and this is the axis about which the disc is rotating. This disc is attached at this point. This is this point where the disc is attached. So the disc is attached to the crankshaft, and the disc is running along with the crankshaft. And on the side of this disc, you have a casing. And here there is a hole. And there is another hole here. So as this disc runs, the hole on this casing and the hole in the disc will match only at some point. And they will match for some angle, theta. So during this angle, the atmosphere is connected to the crankcase. So this means that when the slot in the disc and in the hole in the crankcase, they all match, air can come from the atmosphere into the crankcase. And then when they don't match, the air will be sealed inside the crankcase. Now this is a step beyond what we saw earlier. In the previous case, what we saw was when the piston was moving up, it opened the ports and closed the ports. Here we are not using the piston to open and close the ports. You can see here that the carburetor is connected to the disc, is connected to the crankcase through the disc. So whenever this slot in the disc and the crankcase, they all match, fresh air from the atmosphere can draw fuel from the carburetor and get into the crankcase. Now the advantage here is that you can open and close the disc anywhere with respect to the piston. In the case of a piston control port, if you open the port at some position before top dead center, you will also close the port at the same position after top dead center. Do you get this point? If you open it at X degrees before top dead center, you will also close it at X degrees after top dead center. Whereas in this case, it's not required. You can open the port at bottom dead center and close it at top dead center. Or you can open it at top dead center and close it at bottom center. The disc can be arranged in such a way that the opening and closing of the disc can be at whatever point you want. So this is a step above the piston control port, and which means that you have complete control over the charge induction to the crankcase, which we'll see later. So this is one step. The next arrangement is what is called as a reed valve. The reed valve is the most popular. This is the reed valve, and the reed valve is actually a one-way valve. It's a one-way valve. It allows the charge in this direction, but it does not allow the charge in this direction. It's a one-way valve. So as the piston moves up, whenever the pressure in the crankcase is low, air will run from the atmosphere through the carburetor into the crankcase. Whenever the pressure in the cylinder crankcase becomes high, air will stop. So this is a one-way valve. It's operated by pressure differences. The pressure difference across the valve actually opens and closes the valve. When the pressure here, this is P1 and this is P2. When P1 is less than P2, the valve is open. And when P1 is greater than P2, the valve is closed. So when the piston moves up, the pressure P1 becomes less than the atmospheric pressure. So fresh air gets into the crankcase. When the piston moves down, the pressure in the crankcase becomes higher and no air goes out. So you find that it is a one-way valve. The advantage of this system is that irrespective of engine operation, whenever there is a low pressure in the crankcase, fresh charge will get into the crankcase. Whenever the pressure in the crankcase becomes high, fresh charge will not go out. It will just stop. So the opening and closing of the ports are now completely flexible. They are not fixed. So we now saw three systems for charging. One is the piston control port, the second one was the rotary valve, and the third one was the reed valve. Now we'll compare these three. I'll come back to this. So these are the four timing diagrams of these three systems. Now if you look at the first figure, figure A, on the top left, you see that it's for a piston control port, which we have already seen. As the piston moves up, the inlet valve, inlet port opens here, and the inlet port closes here. This is what we have already seen. And there are equal angles. Whenever the inlet port opens, at the same crank angle, it closes also. And we saw that this is a problem, because during this portion, the fresh air will get inside, and during this portion, the fresh air may tend to go out of the crankcase, which is a disadvantage. And if you tend to push this down, you will also be tending to push this down, which is a disadvantage. Now, on the other hand, I told you with the disc valve, you have complete flexibility. If you look at the disc valve opens somewhere here, and it closes somewhere here. It is not symmetrical. So the opening and closing of the disc valve are now not like the opening and closing of the piston-ported engine. So as the piston moves up, somewhere after bottom dead center itself, the disc valve opens. And as the piston is moving up, it continues to be open, and it closes very close to top dead center. That is somewhat like this. So at this point, you find that the fresh air is about to go out, and when it's about to go out, the disc valve closes. So the disc valve has unsymmetrical timing. So the difference between the piston control port and the disc valve is that the disc valve is unsymmetric. It is also fixed, but it is unsymmetric. Now the third thing is the reed valve. If you look at the reed valve, I told you opens whenever the pressure in the crankcase is low, and it will close whenever the pressure in the crankcase is high. So as the piston moves up, if the engine is running at let us say low speed, this is figure C, the reed valve opens somewhere here, and the reed valve closes somewhere here. So as the piston went up, the pressure in the crankcase went down, somewhere the reed valve opened, fresh air started entering, piston went up, and the piston comes down, and the pressure in the crankcase increases, the reed valve closes. So this entire period is the intake period. So you are able to increase the intake period with the reed valve as compared to the piston-ported engine. So you have more time for the fresh charge to get inside. You can take more air into the engine. This is one advantage. Secondly, you see when the speed changes, the reed valve adjusts itself. When the speed becomes higher, you find that the reed valve's opening point went up to this point and closing point remains somewhere here. So it always works with pressure difference. So it never allows the charge to go out, and it allows the charge only to get into the cylinder. So we see that reed valve is flexible and it changes itself with speed. That is the biggest advantage. The disc valve is not flexible, but it is not symmetrical, so it has an advantage. The disc valve is not symmetrical, that is an advantage, but it is not variable, it is fixed. Once you make the disc, the same timing comes. But piston control port is not flexible and it is not also unsymmetric. It is symmetric and inflexible. So that is the least desired one. But this is the easiest to make. So many small engines still use the piston control port. Most of the automotive engines make use of either the reed valve or the rotary valve. So now the tendency is only to use a reed valve or rotary valve. And amongst this reed valve and rotary valve, the reed valve is still preferred because it is also flexible. So that is what you see from all the port timing diagrams here. Now we look at Now we saw what happened at the bottom of the cylinder. Now we are going to the top of the cylinder. Now we look at the different methods by which one can scavenge the two-stroke engine, or one can remove the exhaust and push the fresh charge into the cylinder. So you are seeing different kinds of scavenging methods here. The first scavenging method you see in figure A is what we call as a cross scavenging method. So this is called cross. Now the cross scavenging method is called cross scavenging just because the exhaust port, this is the exhaust port, and this is the transfer port. The exhaust port and the transfer port are facing each other. So we call it a cross scavenging arrangement. So the charge is actually going across the cylinder. And you find here that the piston has a deflector. The piston has a deflector. That is because the fresh charge which comes inside is pushed by the piston to the roof of the cylinder, and so that it can make a loop. And it will not go directly from here to here. We don't want the fresh charge to directly go from the inlet port to the exhaust port. So the piston stop acts as a deflector. So you have a deflector on the top of the piston. This system is very simple to make. Very simple to make just because the ports are facing each other. So when you manufacture, you can machine one of the ports, and through this port, you can machine the other port. So it's very simple to manufacture, and that is why it was very popular. But now it is not very popular. The reason being that in spite of having a deflector, some of the fresh charge will directly go into the exhaust. So this system leads to scavenging efficiency, which is very low. There is a low scavenging efficiency and trapping efficiency is also
low.
That is, you will lose charge directly through the exhaust, which means trapping efficiency is low. You may also retain a lot of fresh charge, a lot of exhaust, which means that scavenging efficiency is low. So this system invariably leads to low efficiencies, and it is given up almost. There are some applications where it is still used. The one which is very popular is what we see in figure C, and we call this as the loop scavenging method. The loop scavenging method is the one which you see in figure C. And here, if you look at the, I think you also have to look at the plan and the elevation together. Then only the loop scavenging is easy to understand. In the loop scavenging arrangement, the plan view shows there is port 1 here and a symmetric port 2 on the other side. Then there is port 3 here and a symmetric port 4 on the other side. So in this case, you have 4 inlet ports. All these 4 inlet ports connect to the crankcase. So fresh charge comes from the crankcase through these 4 ports, and 1 and 2 are opposite each other, 3 and 4 are opposite each other. So if you see that 1 and 2 are directed towards this point, 3 and 4 are also directed towards this point on the plan view. On the elevation, almost all of them are directed towards this point. So the ports are oriented in such a way that horizontally they are directed at some point, and at an angle also directed somewhere. So all of them meet at this point. So the jets of air which come from different ports all meet at some point here, and they form a loop. So there is a loop of fresh charge which goes out. In fact, you can see that the fresh charge is directed away from the exhaust port. The exhaust port is here. The exhaust port is here, and the fresh charge is actually pushed in a direction which is opposite the exhaust port. So this fresh charge now will not directly go into the exhaust because it is directed on the other side. So these are highly directed ports, and the piston is not doing any work here. The piston is not deflecting the charge. It is the ports that are deflecting the charge. The ports are oriented. So these are oriented ports. So they are difficult to make, but they are quite efficient. And this is called as loop scavenging. In loop scavenging, there can be different methods, but I wish to just stick on to this one. So this is the second method, which is loop scavenging. This is the first method, which is cross scavenging. And it is a loop scavenging method that is very popular. In fact, all moped engines, all two-stroke scooter engines, all of them are loop scavenging, and they all are like this. Sometimes in loop scavenging, you can have even more than 4 ports. There can be 6 ports, 8 ports, all of them inlet, but all of them doing the job of creating a loop inside the cylinder and not depending on the piston for creating the deflection. So these are called as, these have actually flat pistons. So from the piston point of view, this is simpler. From the piston point of view, the cross scavenging engine has a complex piston. It has a deflector on top. The third method of scavenging, which you see here, is called the uniflow scavenging. The uniflow scavenging method is what you see in the third figure, that is D as well as E. And these are done on large engines. These are not seen on small engines. These are typically for large marine engines where you have valves. So on the top you see that there are 2 valves, and both of them in this case are exhaust valves. 2 exhaust valves or even 4 exhaust valves on the top. And at the bottom you see the piston and the ports around the piston. So fresh charge, the piston controls the inlet ports, and the exhaust is controlled by the exhaust valve. So these are exhaust valves, and these are inlet ports. So as the piston moves down, the piston controls the inlet port, and the exhaust valve is driven by a cam, and that is controlled separately. So here, what you do is, as the piston is going down, somewhere at some point, the exhaust valve opens, and the hot exhaust rushes out, and after some time, the piston opens the inlet port, and fresh charge comes from the bottom. So the main advantage here is that the fresh charge comes like this and the exhaust goes like this. So both the fresh charge and the exhaust are going in the same direction. That is why we call it uniflow scavenging. It is like having a tube and filling the tube from one end and emptying it from the other end. So you find that the fresh charge and the exhaust will not mix significantly. So you are able to almost drive all the exhaust out and retain fresh charge as much as possible. But these kinds of engines these kinds of systems make use of a blower. And what is sent here is actually air. And these are normally used for compression ignition engines. They are not used for spark ignition engines. So these are large marine diesel engines where you have a blower which takes in air from the atmosphere and pushes through the bottom ports, and through the top you have an exhaust which is pushing the exhaust out, which is opening out and letting the exhaust out. So these are for large marine engines, and this is called uniflow scavenging, and this gives the highest scavenging efficiency. The scavenging efficiency is extremely high here. The scavenging efficiency is very low in cross, and the scavenging efficiency of loop is somewhere in between. So you have three kinds of machines, and the loop is very, very common in the case of SI engines, and uniflow is very common in the case of CI engines. This is for CI engines. That's what we see here. This uniflow can also be obtained by making use of what is called an opposed cylinder arrangement, which we'll see very soon. I'll show it here. This is the uniflow scavenging with an opposed cylinder arrangement, where you see two crankshafts. Both the crankshafts are geared and connected together, and both these crankshafts operate two pistons, and the two pistons are running on the same cylinder. We call it an opposed piston engine, and one of the pistons is opening the inlet port, the other piston is opening the exhaust port. So you, once again here also you see what is called as uniflow scavenging, but these are all not possible in small engines. These are typically for very, very large engines. Sometimes they take each one of the shafts and make them drive a different, maybe one of the shafts driving one propeller and the other shaft driving another propeller. So all this is possible. It's also possible to see to it that both these pistons do not reach their top dead centers together. There can be a small phase shift. So one reaches top dead center first, then the other one comes. So with a phase difference, they move. And then you can have unsymmetrical scavenging. So this is all possible only in the case of uniflow scavenging, and only for large engines. So I just want to tell you how the PV diagram which we drew earlier actually comes about when we look at all these ports. This is the PV diagram which we drew earlier. Now I'm sort of summarizing it. So what I show on the top is a port timing diagram. This is top dead center. This is bottom dead center. And the crankshaft is rotating, and the piston is moving from top dead center to bottom dead center in this direction. At top dead center, almost at top dead center, there was combustion. And as the piston moves down, somewhere at this point, the exhaust port opens. And from here to here, when the piston is moving from top dead center to bottom dead center, the pressure in the cylinder is high, and it is gradually coming down, like in a four-stroke engine. Somewhere at this point, the exhaust port opens, starts falling, and till the transfer port opens, the pressure suddenly falls, and this is what we called as blowdown, which is what you see here. So that is what I drew earlier. And after the blowdown process, the piston continues to move to bottom dead center, and in this portion, the pressure very slowly falls in the cylinder. And once again, you start compressing from bottom dead center, but compression cannot occur here because the transfer port is, the exhaust port is open, and compression can actually start only from here, and it is here where the pressure actually starts raising. So this is how the two-stroke engine's PV diagram looks. Otherwise, on this side, the two-stroke engine's PV diagram is very similar to the four-stroke engine's PV diagram. There's no difference on this side. But on the right-hand side, there's a lot of difference because of the port opening and closing. And at this point, the pressure can be about 4 bar also. And this is the one which leads to noise. This is how we summarize. Next, I want to tell you something about how the performance of a two-stroke engine can be improved. Now, one of the problems which you saw here was that the exhaust port opens before the transfer port. And in this process, there is blowdown. And because you open the exhaust port before the transfer port, you are also forced to close the exhaust port after the transfer port. And in this period, whatever you took into the cylinder can go out. Are you able to imagine that in this period, whatever we took into the cylinder can go out of the cylinder? Piston is moving from bottom dead center to top dead center, but the exhaust port is open. So whatever was in the cylinder can be pushed out. And if you do not want it to be pushed out, you should close the exhaust port early. But if you close the exhaust port early, you will also open it late. So that's not possible. So we would like to do something outside the engine to prevent this from happening. That is, what we exactly want is, we want to open the exhaust port first, then the transfer port, but we want to close the exhaust port first and then only close the transfer. Or we want to close the exhaust port at the transfer port simultaneously at the as early as possible, which is not possible in a conventional engine. Now this we can do in a tuned exhaust pipe. In a tuned exhaust pipe, what we do is, if this is the exhaust port, and we have an exhaust pipe which is like this. We connect this kind of a pipe to the exhaust of the engine. You see how this can make these changes. So what really happens is, when the exhaust port opens, I told you that the pressure is much above atmospheric pressure. So let us say the pressure is something like 4 bar. So at this point, when the exhaust, when the piston is somewhere here, and the piston is moving down, the pressure in the cylinder was 4 bar. And when the piston just opened this point, that 4 bar pressure appeared in the exhaust pipe. So the exhaust pipe was suddenly disturbed, and at this point the pressure went to 4 bar. Is this clear? Just before the exhaust port opens, the pressure in this exhaust pipe was atmospheric. Just when the exhaust port opens, the pressure suddenly went to 4 bar. So it is like exposing this point to a small explosion. That is, the pressure suddenly was raised there. Now what happens is, this small raise in pressure sends out pressure waves. Pressure waves start traveling from the inlet to the exhaust side, and they travel at sonic speed. So the pressure waves start moving at sonic speed, and whenever there is a change in dimension, whenever there is a change in area, the pressure wave gets reflected. So the pressure wave gets reflected. Actually, as the pressure wave goes here, there is a sudden raise in the area. That means the pressure suddenly drops there. The pressure suddenly drops there, there is a disturbance created, and that disturbance also travels. So what the point to note here is that as the pressure wave travels, if there is a sudden change in area, that sudden change in area creates another pressure difference, and that pressure difference also starts traveling. And if there is a sudden reduction in area, the pressure suddenly raises. If there is a sudden enlargement in area, the pressure suddenly falls. So you should see here that as this pressure wave travels up to the point A, or for example, even if I call this as A, I'm going to change this to B. When the pressure wave goes up to A, at A, there's a sudden enlargement. So at A, there's a sudden drop in pressure. And at A, you send out a wave which goes backwards, or also forwards. So you create a disturbance at A, and that disturbance is a pressure which is dropping, and it travels both forwards and backwards. The backward wave comes back to the engine. You see this? The backward wave comes back to the engine. The forward wave is traveling away from the engine. So this forward wave continues to go once again, and somewhere here there is a sudden contraction. There is a sudden contraction here at C, there is a sudden contraction here at D. So these contractions at C and D, this contraction particularly at C, and then the sudden change at D, these also send out pressure waves. So these pressure waves also start traveling backward. So you see that there is a series of pressure waves traveling backwards, all initiated by the first pressure wave. So when the exhaust port opened, there was the first pressure wave which started traveling out of the engine, and that pressure wave created some disturbances, and those disturbances started traveling back into the engine. And if you very clearly see, the first pressure wave which comes back into the engine is a low pressure wave, because it came from the expansion. The second pressure wave which came was from the contraction. It's a high pressure wave. So now the point to note here is that in the exhaust port, first a pressure wave traveled, and the first pressure wave to come back to the exhaust port was a rarefaction wave. That means it was a pressure wave which decreased its amplitude, because it came from the enlargement. The second pressure wave which came to the exhaust port was a compression wave, because it came from the point C. So you have two waves coming back to the engine. The first wave is a rarefaction wave, the second wave is a compression wave. Now we'll see what this rarefaction wave will do and what this compression wave will do. What's a rarefaction wave? It's a wave which will bring down the pressure, because the pressure has gone down there. A compression wave will raise the pressure. So now let us imagine the whole sequence of things. I'll put the port timing diagram once again. This is the point where the exhaust port opened, This is the point where the transfer port opened, and symmetrically here transfer port closes and the exhaust port closes. We didn't want the exhaust port to close very late. We are trying to avoid this by doing something in the exhaust. So the exhaust port opened here, sent out a wave, and after some time when you reach bottom dead center, the pressure in the cylinder has fallen down. Now there is the rarefaction wave which comes first. That is, the rarefaction wave comes to this point. That means a low pressure comes to the exhaust port. If a low pressure comes to the exhaust port, can I say that it will suck the exhaust out? If a low pressure wave comes to the exhaust port, that means the pressure in the exhaust port is below atmospheric. So the exhaust will be sucked from the cylinder. And it is beneficial because exhaust was initially flowing because of pressure difference, then it is not flowing. So this negative wave will, this rarefaction wave will pull the exhaust out. So it will remove all the exhaust properly. But if it continues for a long time, fresh charge also will come out. By that time, what happens, this compression wave comes behind it. The compression wave comes behind it and arrives at some point somewhere here. So at this point, the compression wave comes, and somewhere here, the rarefaction wave comes. So when the piston is almost at bottom dead center, the rarefaction wave comes and pulls the exhaust out. And after some time, the compression wave from point C and D comes again and then plugs the exhaust. That means even though the exhaust port is open here, nothing will flow from the engine out because you put a high pressure at that point. And when these waves will return back depends on how much time they take. Is this clear? And how much time they take will depend on all these lengths. This length L1 and this length L2. So this sonic wave will travel from this point to A, get reflected and come back. That will come back as rarefaction wave. It will come back quickly because the length L1 is small. After some time, from the length L2, you will get a compression wave. That will come back late. So the first rarefaction wave will pull the exhaust out. The second compression wave will plug the exhaust. So even though the exhaust port is closing after the transfer port, the plugging of the exhaust occurs and nothing will flow out of the exhaust. It's as good as blocking the exhaust. But the exhaust was open, but you blocked it with the high pressure. So by tuning the exhaust pipe, you will be able to bring these waves at the right point and improve the performance of the engine. Now, how do you tune? Is by changing the lengths L1 and L2. You want the exhaust pressure waves to come at the right time. So if that is what racing motorcycles, when they tune a racing motorcycle, a two-stroke motorcycle, this is what they do. They play with the exhaust pipe. They put a new exhaust pipe and all that. What they do is actually this. They tune all these lengths so they get the pressure at the right point. Unfortunately, there is a problem here. It will work well at one engine speed. It will not work well at the other engine speed because all the waves have to come at the right time. They will come at the right time for one speed. At another speed, they won't come at the right time. So this tuning is done only for one speed. It doesn't work over a range of speeds. So I wanted to only tell that by tuning the exhaust pipe, you can improve the performance of a two-stroke engine. And you can get over some of the problems that you have because the exhaust port and transfer ports are closed late. And they are closed late because the piston is opening and closing the exhaust port and transfer port. This is what we see here. I don't know, they said sometime they want to break. I think they said 3:15 or something. So we can break for about 10 minutes, have a coffee and come back. Now you can check whether it is.
We continue? Shall I start? So we can continue for 10 more minutes. Maybe by the time this two-stroke portion will almost cover. I just wanted to finally put this performance curve and then look at how we can improve the two-stroke engine. Now this performance is a typical performance curve. On the x-axis you should see the air-fuel ratio. I told you that the chemically correct air-fuel ratio is around 14.5:1. So you can see here that we are using mixtures which are less than 14.5:1, that is rich mixture. So this is rich and this is lean. So we have rich and lean, and somewhere here we have the chemically correct mixture. So we have gone on both sides. Now if you recollect what I told you earlier, in the two-stroke engine you have two main problems. One is short-circuiting and the other one is charge dilution. Now we would like to know when the problem of short-circuiting will be very high and when the problem of charge dilution will be very high. When do you think the problem of short-circuiting will be very high? We'll look at this from the point of view of opening the throttle. We'll imagine a two-stroke engine is running at some constant speed and we are simply opening the throttle. And as we open the throttle, what we are doing is allowing more and more charge into the cylinder. That means what we are changing is the delivery ratio or the volumetric efficiency. When I open the throttle, I'm changing the delivery ratio. Now we'll now compare two operating conditions. One is fully open throttle and the other one is partly open throttle. So I call full throttle and part throttle, FT and PT. FT is full throttle, PT is part throttle. Now let us take a condition where we put it at FT. If I put it at FT, I'm sending maximum amount of charge into the cylinder. Now will you have charge dilution problem or you won't have? If I send a lot of charge into the cylinder, do you think I'll have charge dilution problem? When I send lot of fresh charge into the cylinder, will I retain lot of exhaust? Charge dilution is because of exhaust that is retained. So if I send lot of fresh charge into the cylinder, I'll not retain lot of exhaust. So charge dilution will be less. So when the delivery ratio is high, charge dilution will be low. If charge dilution is low, can I say combustion will be good? There is no exhaust inside the cylinder, so combustion will be good. So in a two-stroke engine, at full throttle, there will be no charge dilution and combustion will be good. So this is one aspect to see. At part throttle, you are sending very small amount of charge into the cylinder, and that small amount of charge into the cylinder will not push all the exhaust out. So there will be a lot of exhaust in the cylinder and you will find that your dilution will be very high. So at part throttle, combustion will not be good in a two-stroke engine. Can I say that? Full throttle combustion will be good, part throttle combustion will not be good. Full throttle no charge dilution, part throttle heavy charge dilution. So at part throttle, what kind of mixture should you use to run the engine if there is too much of charge dilution? Too much of charge, there is lot of dilution with exhaust, a very lean mixture may not burn. So you will be forced to use a rich mixture. So in a two-stroke engine, at part throttle, you will be forced to use a rich mixture because of charge dilution. On the other hand, at full throttle, you don't need a rich mixture because there is no charge dilution. But at full throttle, I'll tell you there is another problem. At full throttle, there will be a problem of overheating. Why should an engine overheat at full throttle? At full throttle, yes, cooling is not proper. At full throttle, what happens is you are trying to generate maximum power from the engine. That means you are trying to burn a lot of fuel. When you try to burn a lot of fuel, the temperature of the components will naturally go up because you have to dissipate a lot of heat. And to dissipate a lot of heat, the temperature of the components will go up. So you find that at full throttle, one of the main problems is overheating of the engine. Now, how do you cool the engine? Maybe you use air or water or whatever to cool the engine. But with all this also, the engine will overheat. And what happens if the engine overheats? It fails. You will have loss of lubrication, you will have knocking and all that. So in a two-stroke engine, you normally have problems of overheating at full throttle. It is more than a four-stroke engine. Why is it more than a four-stroke engine? A two-stroke engine develops double the power of a four-stroke engine for the same size. So for the same size, it is developing double power, means it will also generate more heat in unit time. So it has to dissipate more heat, so it goes to higher temperatures. So the problem at full throttle is overheating. It is not charge dilution. and how to prevent overheating, whatever cooling you do from outside, it's not enough. So you do cooling from inside. And how do you do cooling from inside? One is lubrication. The other one is using a rich mixture. So can I say that if you use a rich mixture, the temperature of the charge will be low? If I use a rich mixture, the temperature of the charge is low. I just make a statement. Does it appeal to you? When you add fuel to air, can I say that when fuel vaporizes in air, the temperature of air will come down? Because it has to take its latent heat. So if you use a rich mixture, you're putting more fuel into the same amount of air. So the charge temperature will go down. So one of the ways of cooling an engine with by internally cooling the engine is by using a rich mixture. So you find even motorcycle engines, even four-stroke motorcycle engines, when you go to full throttle, they use a rich mixture. It is not because of combustion. It is just because of overheating. Otherwise, the engine will fail. So in a two-stroke engine, is a severe problem. So at full throttle, you will use a rich mixture. So mixture at full throttle will be rich, and this is used for preventing overheating. Mixture at part throttle will be rich, and this will be used to prevent bad combustion because of dilution. Charge dilution occurs at part throttle. And if you want the combustion to occur even in a diluted charge, you need to use a rich mixture. So what does it mean? In a two-stroke engine, you normally tend to use a rich mixture. Be it part throttle or full throttle, you want to use a rich mixture. Otherwise, you will not be able to sustain combustion properly. Full throttle for overheating, preventing overheating, part throttle to sustain combustion. So this is one very important thing in a two-stroke engine. So mixture will be richer than a four-stroke engine.
Sir, the T is ready.
Okay. So we'll have T and come back since it's ready.
So all centers we'll break for 10 minutes and again reassemble. Thank you.
So we are looking at the performance of the two-stroke engine. We saw that at full throttle we have the problem of overheating, so we use a rich mixture. At part throttle we have the problem of charge dilution by retained exhaust, and because of that also we use a rich mixture. Well, if you look at the problem of short circuiting, which is the other problem in the two-stroke engine, at part throttle, we don't have the problem of short circuiting. We are sending in a small amount of charge, and that charge does not go out. It stays inside. So at part throttle, we don't have short circuiting. At full throttle, we send a large amount of charge, so there can be short circuiting. So now we look at the implications of short circuiting and charge dilution on performance. Now, if there is short circuiting, it means that you are losing fresh charge. Fresh charge is going out. So short circuiting will directly lead to hydrocarbon emissions. Can I say that? Whatever, if there is short circuiting, fresh charge is going out of the exhaust. And if fresh charge goes out of the exhaust, fuel is going out of the exhaust. So hydrocarbon emissions will be high. So in a two-stroke engine, because of short circuiting, HC levels will go up. And HC levels will be high at full throttle because of short circuiting. This is one point. Now the second thing is, if the combustion is not good, what do you mean by combustion not being good? That means some of the fuel inside the cylinder will not burn. So then also hydrocarbons will be very high. So in a two-stroke engine, at part throttle also hydrocarbon emissions will be high. But at part throttle, they'll be high because of charge dilution. At full throttle, HC will be high because of short circuiting. So HC in a two-stroke engine will generally be high. At full throttle, the HC is because of short circuiting. At part throttle, it is because of dilution. So that's what you see here on the right-hand side. On the right-hand side, you see here that at full throttle, the hydrocarbon levels are very high. And this is just because of short circuiting and rich mixtures. So you use rich mixtures, you also have a lot of short circuiting. So the net result is that hydrocarbon levels in a two-stroke engine at full throttle are very high. They can be something like even 5 to 10 times higher than a 4-stroke engine. Because simply fuel is going out of the engine. Whatever you send is being short-circuited. On the other hand, at part throttle, you find that the HC emissions are not so high. They are not so high because short-circuiting is not a big problem. And at part throttle, hydrocarbon levels become high only when charge dilution becomes a problem. When does charge dilution become a problem? And the air-fuel ratio becomes very, very lean. So as you go to the right, you find at part throttle, the hydrocarbon levels are going up. The black line is for part throttle. So it went up because the mixture became very lean. So when the mixture becomes very lean, at part throttle, you are not able to sustain combustion because there is a lot of exhaust inside the cylinder. Whereas in the case of full throttle, the hydrocarbon levels are always high just because of short circuiting, and when the mixture becomes lean, full throttle does not have any problem. And when the mixture becomes lean, at full throttle you don't have any problems because full throttle there is charge dilution. Next lecture I'll change the mode, I won't use this. So this is what you see here. So on the whole, you find that at full throttle everywhere the hydrocarbon levels are high. At part throttle generally it is low. When the mixture becomes very lean, and when it becomes very lean, you have you have the problem of dilution and misfire. At full throttle, you always have high HC levels just because of short circuiting and mixture being rich. So a two-stroke engine is bad from the point of view of hydrodynamics. When you come to the fuel consumption, which is shown on the left-hand side, the fuel consumption is also related to short circuiting. If fuel is directly beating short circuiting, fuel consumption will be high. So you find that at full throttle, which is this line, the fuel consumption is high all the time, and it is high just because of short circuit. At part throttle, it is low because short circuiting is not very high. It becomes high when the mixture becomes very lean because combustion becomes bad. Firing is not good. So you have irregular combustion. So in general, you can say that full throttle performance of a two-stroke engine is inferior to part throttle performance because you have a lot of short circuiting. And when you go to very, very low levels of throttle, you have a problem of charge dilution and misfiring. So hydrocarbon levels are dominated by short circuiting. Hydrocarbon levels are also dominated by dilution. And dilution at part throttle and short circuiting at full throttle. This is what you see here. So if you want to improve a two-stroke engine, all that we need to do is prevent short circuiting and prevent dilution. Both have to be done, which is very, very difficult. So I'm just going to tell you one solution and stop with that and go to the next slide. The one solution to prevent this is to inject the fuel. That is, you inject the fuel into the cylinder. Now, if you can make an engine, two-stroke engine, where during the compression process, you don't take any fuel at all. You only take air. Do the scavenging. And then during the compression process, when the ports are closed, afterwards you put the fuel into the cylinder. Then you don't lose any fuel. Then short circuiting is completely avoided. So the best way to prevent short circuiting in a two-stroke engine is to directly inject the fuel. Inject the fuel after the ports close. So you simply put the fuel into the cylinder after all the ports close, then you don't lose any charge. And then there is no short circuiting. And if there is no short circuiting, your hydrocarbon levels will come down, fuel consumption also will come down. These two are the benefits. But putting the fuel into the cylinder is not an easy thing because it calls for a very complicated system, as we'll see in the next lecture. Now the other problem is dilution. Dilution cannot be avoided by injection. Because dilution is because of exhaust being retained. So if you want to prevent dilution, you have to push the exhaust properly out. And that depends only on how well you have designed the ports. So port design, that is how well you have designed, prevents dilution. So if you design the ports well in a two-stroke engine, do the scavenging process properly, don't push all the exhaust out properly, then you will be able to get good performance at diluted conditions, that means part throttle. If you inject the fuel into the cylinder, you will get good performance at full throttle. So this is how we can improve a two-stroke engine. So I wish to stop at this point for the two-stroke engine and then continue with injection in the next lecture, which is what we are going to see now. And I don't want to also use this very interactive mode because there's some problem with the slide changing and writing here. So I'll use the regular mode. Maybe you're also more comfortable with that. Because the slide automatically changes. I don't know if there's some problem. So if you have any questions, you can ask me. And then I'll go to the next one. Sorry, deflector piston. Deflector, almost all the pistons are cast. They are cast and then they are machined. They are normally not even pressure die cast. Sometimes only pressure die cast. Otherwise, they are simply cast. It's not under pressure. And then they are machined. The deflector is not machined usually. Deflector is as cast. But these deflector piston engines are not very common. Flat piston engines are more common. So the next topic would be gasoline engine management, how we manage a gasoline engine. So I don't think we'll be able to finish that topic today. So I'll give an introduction to it and then we'll continue tomorrow morning. So I'll start that topic. I'll put it in the normal mode. Thank you. I have a pointer. So the next topic which we'll finish up.
Yes.
So the next topic which we'll do is spark ignition engine control. I'll follow it up with diesel engine control, and then turbocharging, and then finally cylinder pressure measurement. That's how we'll go. And I will not do that writing on this because there is some problem, as I told you. So today we'll just start with the basics of spark ignition engine control. Why we need to control a spark ignition engine, and then we'll see how modern spark ignition engines are controlled. That is what we'll see maybe tomorrow. Now, if you look at an automotive engine, what do we actually expect from an automotive engine? When you drive, you want a very high torque because you want the engine to be, you want the car to respond to whatever you want to. You press the accelerator, you want it to accelerate. You remove your foot from the accelerator, you want it to decelerate. So you want the car to respond to what you want to do. And one of the requirements for it to respond to what you want to do is for it to have a very high torque. If an engine cannot exert a very high torque, it cannot really accelerate. Because while accelerating, you cannot be changing gears all the time. You would like to accelerate quickly. You would like to overtake another vehicle, let us say. Or you would like to climb a hill. Or you would like to suddenly gain speed. And that you don't want to always be changing gears. So by itself, an engine has to have a high torque. So that is why we see that nowadays cars are equipped with even something like, some of the cars are equipped with say 150 kilowatt engine. We never need 100 kilowatt, 50 kilowatts to drive. But why we have 150 kilowatt engine is only because the torque that you want can be got only from 150 kilowatt engine. It's not the power that you want, it's the torque that you actually require to accelerate. So high torque is a requirement. High torque means you have to burn more fuel, you have to make the engine robust, it has to be strong, and it should be able to produce very high pressures inside the cylinder. So that's one requirement. The next thing that we also require is low weight and low volume. This is obvious. If you have a very small engine producing high torque, then its mass comes down, so you can reduce the weight of the car. When the weight of the car reduces, acceleration is better. When the weight reduces, fuel economy is better. So many cost is less. So many advantages by reducing the weight and also the volume. So this again means the same as the first one. If you want an engine to be very small, then it has to produce high torque. If it produces high torque, then you can make it smaller and smaller because the torque is anyway produced. So both of them actually go together, high torque, low weight and volume. Then as a user, we always want good fuel economy. Unfortunately, high torque and fuel economy normally don't go together. The moment you make an engine for high torque, it is meant to consume a lot of fuel, it is meant to produce high pressures, so it is robust. So when you want to produce, so it automatically has bigger components, it automatically has inherently higher friction, so it doesn't produce very good fuel economy. On the fuel economy side, it suffers. So you want that also. So as a user, you want high torque on one side and you want good fuel economy on the other side. Then from the emission point of view, emission registrations, they want low emissions, low hydrocarbon emissions, low carbon monoxide emissions, and low oxides of nitrogen in a petrol engine. And again, low emissions and good fuel economy don't go together. When you want low emissions, we'll see later on that it's not possible to have good fuel economy in a normal engine. These two don't go together. Then you want ease of maintenance. The car should be simple, should be easy to maintain. We now have lot of electronics, but still it is not very complicated. You can still drive and it doesn't give you problems. So it has to be simple and easy to maintain. It should give good transient response. When you press, it should immediately accelerate. When you remove the accelerator, it should immediately decelerate. So it should respond to what you want immediately. And response comes from lot of good management of the engine, as we'll see. So good transient response. And it should also adapt to what the driver wants. In fact, there are cars which can switch modes. You can run from a sporty mode. You can tune the car to run as a very sporty car, like very high torque and very good acceleration and all that. Or you can switch modes and say it has to run with a good fuel economy. So there are mode switching which is also possible. So you should change depending on what the driver wants. So it should be able to adapt. And it should also change depending on the environment. Suppose the temperature of the atmosphere changes, the car should be able to sense that and make changes to its controller. Or the engine overheats, it should be able to modify itself. or the air filter is clogged, over a period of time the air filter is clogged, the engine should adapt itself. So it should be able to adapt to the environmental conditions, to the conditions which it sees, and then work. So there are a lot of things that we actually expect from an automotive engine, which are very, very diverse, and some of them are actually conflict. They are not going together, but still we want all this. And that is why a good controller is essential. Now, if you look at a gasoline engine, I just start with this basic figure which tells how the combustion in the gasoline engine occurs and how many things in a gasoline engine are very important from the point of view of emissions. If you take a gasoline engine, we use what is called as a homogeneous mixture. The air and fuel are essentially mixed outside the engine. We take this air and fuel mixture into the cylinder, then we compress this air and fuel mixture, and we have a spark somewhere at the center, which as we see here, and that creates a flame. So flame is actually a burning gas, and it's flame is actually a boundary. You can say it's a boundary between the gas that has burned and the gas that is to burn. So it's an imaginary boundary where chemical reactions are occurring. So I can say that a flame is propagating from here to the end of the lab, end of this room, which means it's a boundary, and that boundary separates what is ahead of it, which is unburned, and what is behind it is burned, and this flame is traveling. And the flame travels with some velocity called flame velocity. And the flame velocity depends on the conditions inside this room. For example, it would depend on the amount of air and fuel you have, air fuel mixture, air fuel ratio. It would depend on the temperature, it would depend on the pressure. All this would govern how fast the flame moves. It would also depend on turbulence. Suppose I have air and fuel mixture inside this room which is not moving at all, stationary. Flame moves in some order. If I have this air and fuel mixture being agitated by a fan, then the flame moves faster. Because the burned gas and unburned gas mix with each other, then the flame moves faster. So this flame which propagates has what is called as flame velocity. It takes some time for the flame to start from the center and move to the edge. And the time it takes depends on the distance it has to travel and the velocity. And this velocity can be changed by many ways. One of the important ways is turbulence. That is, I give turbulence, I do something to create turbulence, then the flame velocity can be enhanced. So flame velocity is a parameter which is under the control of the designer. He can do something to it. How we can do, we'll see. Now this flame travels and it does not go up to the end of the cylinder. So this is the cylinder. So as you can see here, it is a cross section of the cylinder. From the spark, the flame moves. Let us say this is the end of the cylinder. It doesn't go and touch the wall of the cylinder. It stops before the wall. As you can see here, I put two rings there. That's why. The inner ring is where the flame drops. It cannot go beyond that. So the flame really does not touch the wall. Why it does not touch the wall is because at the wall the temperature is low, and at the wall you cannot burn. Can I say that for the fuel air mixture to burn, you need to have some temperature below that the chemical reactions stop, and the wall is cold. The wall is cool, so the flame cannot really go to the wall because at the wall you cannot have combustion. So just before the wall, the flame stops. So the point I want to tell you make here is that near the wall there is always a layer which does not burn. So you cannot take the flame up to the wall. And this layer which is near the wall is called the quench layer. The flame is actually quenched before it goes to the wall. And what does this layer contain? It contains fuel and air. So what will be its result? It is something like short-circuited fuel of a two-stroke engine. So this layer which is not burned comes out as hydrocarbon emissions. So in a spark ignition engine, this quench layer is the one which creates hydrocarbon emissions. Mostly the hydrocarbon emissions come from the quench layer. And the quench layer depends on how much you can propagate the flame. If you can push the flame very close to the wall, then the quench layer becomes small. And if you want the flame to go very close to the wall, what can you do? You can raise the temperature of the wall. And you can move closer and closer to the wall. Or you can create some turbulence near the wall, so that whatever is near the wall is brought inside and burnt. So again, it's under the influence of the designer. So the designer can adopt methods so the flame can go as close to the wall as possible. And then he can bring down hydrocarbons. So almost all designers would have done all this. So you find that still in an SI engine, some hydrocarbons come out. That is because of still the flame does not touch the wall. It stops short of the wall. So Now, the thing that we have to note here is that hydrocarbon emissions will be formed in an SI engine near the wall, and they will come out unburned. Maybe some of it will be burned later, but a lot of it will come unburned. So even in a well-designed engine, you will have hydrocarbon emissions. It will come out because there will be many parts like this where the flame cannot go. One part could be when you tighten the spark plug, there are threads of the spark plug, and the threads sit in the cylinder head. There may be a gap between the threads between the spark plug and the cylinder head. And in that gap, the flame cannot travel because it's too cold there for the flame to travel. So that hydrocarbon will come out as hydrocarbon. So many points like this will emit hydrocarbons. And these are all points which here we call as quench points. So quench layers. I have shown this in an exaggerated way here as a quench layer. So that layer is the one which emits hydrocarbons, as I shown you. Wall quench hydrocarbons. Flame front, spark plug. Then the other thing is oxides of nitrogen. Now, when you burn fuel in air, the temperature goes up. And if you cross temperatures of the order of about 1400 Kelvin and all that, then oxides of nitrogen start forming. They become very important. Till then, the rate of formation of oxides of nitrogen is low. But when you cross a certain threshold temperature, oxides of nitrogen start forming. And you very easily cross these temperatures in the engine. So near the flame, at the boundary of the flame, or in the region where combustion has already occurred, temperatures are very high. And here you can have formation of NOx. NOx is formed by the oxygen and nitrogen available in air. So to form NOx, you need oxygen. Nitrogen is always there. And you also need high temperatures. So three things are required: high temperature, oxygen, nitrogen. If you have all the three, you have oxides and nitrogen. So nitrogen is always there, because when you take air, about 70% or more is nitrogen. Only thing is, oxygen may or may not be there. And when will oxygen be there? If the mixture is lean. And when will oxygen be there? When the mixture is lean. When the mixture is rich, that means you have more fuel than the oxygen that is required. Than the oxygen that is available. So when you have more fuel than the oxygen that is available, you will not have oxygen for formation of NOx. So you find that NOx will be formed in the engine, and for NOx to be formed, you need oxygen and high temperature. Wherever both exist, NOx will be formed. This we'll keep in mind. So NOx also will be formed in the cylinder somewhere, because temperatures will be high, and at many points you will have enough oxygen for formation of NOx. So the third pollutant is CO, carbon monoxide. Where does carbon monoxide get formed? It forms whenever you don't have enough oxygen for combustion of the carbon atoms that you have. So it forms, it gets formed only when the mixture is rich. It doesn't get formed when the mixture is lean. So if you look at the entire contents of the cylinder, somewhere if you have rich pockets here and there, then it is those points where carbon monoxide will be formed. So in the cylinder, even though you have a homogeneous mixture, you will have locations where carbon monoxide will be formed, because it is not perfectly homogeneous. You will have high temperature locations where oxides of nitrogen will be formed. You will have quenching near the walls where hydrocarbons will be formed. All the three will always be formed. How much they will be formed will depend on the operating condition and the engine design. So this is what we see in the SI. Apart from that, I have seen something like end gas here. This end gas. So as the flame propagates down through the cylinder, you find that the portion near the wall, which is farthest from the flame, is getting gradually compressed. Can I say that? The pressure in the cylinder is going up. So gases which are not burnt near the wall, they are all raising their temperature. And sometimes they may go to a high temperature where they may self-ignite even without the flame coming there. Even before this flame reaches the wall, this gas near the wall explodes on its own, because it has been taken to a high temperature. And that we call as auto-ignition. Auto-ignition is ignition of the charge far away from the flame by itself, not because of the flame, because it has been raised to a high temperature. And if auto-ignition occurs, it is like an explosion. So everything which is not burned will suddenly burn. And this is called end gas auto-ignition, because it's at the end. And auto-ignition will lead to knock, K-N-O-C-K, knock. That means there will be sudden explosion, sudden raise in pressure. And this also can lead to NOx, because temperatures will go up. So auto-ignition will lead to K-N-O-C-K, knock, and it will also lead to NOx, knocks. Both will come together and it will lead to engine damage. So these are all that you see in the SI engine. And if you want to manage an SI engine, you should take it first of all to its limits. That is, you want to take it to high torque. High torque means high temperature. But you want high temperature and no NOx. So you are operating at some border. So you should take it to high temperatures, but still see that there is no NOx being formed. You should take it to a high temperature, but still see that there is no KNOC, KNOC occurring. So you need to control all parameters so that you are at the border of all this. Just about NOx, just sufficient, just the tolerable level of NOx and things like that. So this is what is about engine management, which we'll see as we proceed. So how do we really achieve good performance in an SI engine, given all these problems? First of all, whatever air is there in the cylinder, we would like to utilize it completely. If you do not utilize all the air, so let us say I have 1 kilogram of air. I need to put, let us say, 1 by 15 kilograms of air, fuel into it to burn. I should utilize every small volume of every pocket of air inside completely. If I do not utilize it, it means that I am not developing the maximum power that the engine can develop. Because some of the air which I have taken, I have not used. It is like as good as not using fuel. Because I could have put some more fuel and utilized that air. Then I could have got more power. So one important thing is to utilize air completely. That means make as uniform a mixture as possible and utilize all the air in the cylinder. So that is what we should achieve. This is achieved by design, not by control. To some extent by control, but mostly by design. The second thing is take as much of air as possible. That means maximize the volumetric efficiency. We saw delivery ratio on the two-stroke engine. You maximize that. That means if the piston moves by 500 cc, take at least 500 cc of air. So you should be able to completely fill the cylinder with air. So maximum amount of air, so we call it high volumetric efficiency, or take the largest quantity of air so that you develop high torque, high power. So this is the second thing which you have to do. This is also done by engine management and by engine design. Third one is have the highest possible flame velocity, which I showed here. Make the flame to move as quickly as possible. If it moves very quickly, this N-gas auto-ignition will not occur. Because by the time that N-gas auto-ignites, this flame goes and consumes it. So try to move the flame as rapidly as possible. So that is the third requirement. Fourth requirement is burn all the fuel completely. Just like how you don't want to leave any air unutilized, leave no fuel unutilized. Everything is completely burnt. So you try to go to carbon dioxide, not stay at carbon monoxide, not stay at hydrocarbons, complete combustion. Only water and CO2 should be there. That will be the aim. Then the fifth requirement is, even though combustion is occurring, don't raise it to very high temperatures. Control the temperature of the combustion process so that NOx will not be formed. So because high temperature is the one which leads to NOx. Then after burning, completely expand the gases. We saw in the two-stroke engine, you are not able to expand the gases fully when you open the exhaust port. When the exhaust port opens, the pressure is about 4 bar. That leads to a lot of losses, that leads to noise. So if you can expand down to ambient pressure, then you get more work. So expand the gases completely. This again is a requirement. Don't lose a lot of heat to the wall. Use all the heat to produce work, as much as possible to produce work, so that you don't lose heat to the wall, so avoid heat transfer losses. And above all, have a very sound control strategy, which is what I am going to discuss today. So do a control process which is very sound so that you can manage the engine properly to get all this simultaneously or as efficiently as possible. So a sound control strategy becomes very important in modern engines because everything is already designed well. The engine has gone to some limit, but then it's only about control. Is this clear? Shall I move to the next slide?
Sir, when combustion is complete, say we want only the water and CO2.
Ideally.
But then that means nitrogen goes out as such?
Ideally, we don't want, nitrogen and oxygen may combine to form NOx. But ideally, that is why it is not too high peak temperatures. If the temperatures are low, NOx will also be low. What I am trying to tell is the ideal limits. So how much we can achieve depends on how well we have
NOx will be minimized.
We would like to minimize NOx. We cannot eliminate. Now, how do you really, now we are looking at only emissions. Now I'm focusing only on emissions. Now if you look at, I just want to make one point. If you look at all the cars that are running today, most of them, gasoline cars, maybe 99% of them on Indian roads are NPFI engines. the multi-point fuel injected engines. Multi-point fuel injected engines primarily aim at reducing emissions. Their prime target is emissions. They have become popular just because they can bring down emissions significantly. They are not meant to produce very high efficiencies or power. They sacrifice efficiency to get emissions, to minimize emissions. So that's why I first started with emissions. So if you want to remove emissions, if you want to reduce emissions, first we should know what are the factors that control emissions and how they are related to the performance of the SI. So first I took air fuel ratio. The most important parameter in an engine is the air to fuel ratio. If you can control air to fuel ratio properly, you can control emissions, you can control its performance. Now I want to define two parameters which we'll very often use. One is called equivalence ratio and the other one is called excess air ratio. Equivalence ratio is normally given the symbol phi and excess air ratio is normally given the symbol lambda. Both are equivalent, that is one can be got from the other. Only thing is some places they use phi, some places they use lambda. Traditionally in Europe they use phi, in US they use lambda. And in India we generally use phi, we generally don't use lambda. But you will see literature giving lambda and phi and both can be got, one can be got from the other. So what do you mean by equivalence ratio or equivalence ratio? Equivalence ratio is basically, it tells you, I will define it later tomorrow. Equivalence ratio basically tells you whether the mixture is rich or lean. If the value of equivalence ratio is greater than 1, then the mixture is rich. If the value of equivalence ratio is less than 1, then the mixture is lean. So 1 is stoichiometric. 1 means you have chemically correct amount of air and fuel. Greater than 1 is rich, lesser than 1 is lean. Lambda is exactly the opposite. Greater than 1 is exactly. Greater than 1 is lean and lesser than 1 is rich. So these two are equivalent. I mean, you can see the equivalence. Now, what is air fuel ratio control? In a spark ignition engine, air fuel ratio significantly controls the kind of ignition that you should have. Suppose you have a very, very lean mixture, it is very difficult to ignite. You have a spark, the mixture may not ignite. We saw it in the case of the two-stroke engine, I told you. In a diluted charge, if you have a lean mixture, it won't burn. So you need to have a strong spark. So it controls ignition. Air fuel ratio controls flame velocity, the velocity with which the flame will go, and that controls knocking efficiency and so on. Air fuel ratio also controls the completeness of combustion. I'll give you an example. If you have equivalence ratio which is greater than 1, it means that you have more fuel than you can tolerate, rich mixture. That is, you put, for a given amount of air put, you put more fuel. So how can this fuel ever burn? So you cannot have complete combustion. So for completeness of combustion, equivalence ratio has to be 1 or less than 1. Only then you can have completeness of combustion. Completeness of combustion, flame velocity, all this relate to efficiency. So air fuel ratio affects efficiency. If you do not have completeness of combustion, how can you have high efficiency? Not possible. And then finally I will show how very strongly equivalence ratio affects emissions, which you will see in the next graph. Maybe I will go to that graph and come back. This is a graph which shows the influence of air fuel ratio on emissions. We'll perhaps stop at this graph. This is a very important graph when you look at an SI engine. And I think this tells everything about the emissions of an SI engine. On the x-axis, you see lambda, which is excess air ratio. It is not equivalence ratio. So one is stoichiometric. On this side, it is lean. On this side, it is rich, because it's lambda. This is stoichiometric. Now you can see here, three pollutants being plotted. Hydrocarbons, carbon monoxide, and oxides of nitrogen. This is a very interesting graph. It will tell, it also shows how engines have been transformed. See, if you look at this carbon monoxide graph, which is the easiest to understand, you see that when the mixture is rich, and the mixture is rich and you are somewhere here, carbon monoxide levels are high. It is obvious. You don't have air, so carbon cannot be completely burned to carbon dioxide, so a lot of carbon monoxide. So it gradually forms. Ideally, it should become zero at 1. Ideally, it should become 0 at 1, but it is not becoming 0 at 1. At 1, there is a small level of carbon monoxide. Definitely, it should become 0 here because there is too much of air, but it is not becoming 0. It is still some value. This is because it is deviating from what really happened, what we really think theoretically. The reason is this. When you go to this region, where there is a lot of air, even then there are small pockets where air and fuel are not uniformly mixed. You get my point? Overall, I put the correct amount of air and fuel, but somewhere in different regions I don't mix it properly. So there is a region where there is more fuel, there's another region where there is more air. So this is not uniform. So somewhere there is some carbon monoxide being formed, and that is why even when the mixture becomes very, very lean, you still have small amounts of carbon monoxide. So an engine emits very, very small levels of carbon monoxide always. But when you go rich, it becomes very high. And even near stoichiometric, it is high because of the same reason. There is richness and leanness. So if you want to avoid carbon monoxide, you have to go lean. You go lean, you will avoid carbon monoxide. Now we'll take the other emission, hydrocarbons. Hydrocarbon depends entirely on how well you can burn. Now if you look at hydrocarbons, it becomes minimum at slightly lean mixtures. It raises at rich mixtures, which is obvious because you have more fuel than air, so hydrocarbons do not burn. But why should it raise even in lean mixtures? This is something which is in. The reason is that when you make the mixture leaner and leaner, you cannot sustain combustion. Or incomplete combustion, and that is because of leanness. So if you look at hydrocarbons, the best air fuel ratio to use is slightly lean. If you use too lean, it's bad. If you use slightly lean, it is good. But slightly lean does not give you very low CO. So you now, right now itself, we saw that there are, when you want to control CO, you cannot control HC. When you want to control HC, you cannot control CO. The conflict has come now itself. It becomes severe when you look at NOx. Now let us look at NOx. NOx is low in rich mixtures. Why is it low at rich mixtures? Rich mixtures do not have oxygen because you put too much of fuel in air, and that fuel takes off all the oxygen. There is no oxygen left for formation of NOx. So rich mixtures, no NOx. Lean mixtures also no NOx. Why? Oxygen is there, but no temperature. So you find that NOx doesn't form with lean mixtures, NOx doesn't form with rich mixtures. It forms at nearly stoichiometric mixtures. But at exactly stoichiometric mixtures, it is not maximum. It is slightly lean that it is maximum. Why? Exactly at stoichiometric mixtures, temperatures are very high, but no oxygen is available because the fuel has taken away all the oxygen. But slightly lean, if you go, temperature is reasonably high and some oxygen is also available. So the point to note is that NOx peaks when mixture is slightly lean. So a relative air fuel ratio or lambda of 1.05, 1.1, there NOx will become maximum. And wherever NOx becomes maximum, HC is minimum, almost minimum. And CO is also reasonably low. So now again you see that when you want to control NOx, you cannot control HC. So to control NOx, you may want to go here. And if you go here, HC is high. Or if you go here also, HC and CO are high. So you don't have a sweet spot for emissions. You do one emission, the other emission goes up. So this is a big problem. So earlier, for example, in the late 70s, early 80s, people were worried only about hydrocarbons and carbon monoxide and not so much about NOx. So what they were doing is actually go lean, go somewhere here, so that you have reasonably low level of NOx, reasonably low level of HC, and reasonably low level of CO. So if you look at the engines of 80s and all that, they'll be tuned to operate with a lean mixture. They'll try to operate with a lean mixture where NOx will be reasonably low, HC will be reasonably low, and CO will also be low. But this level of emissions are maybe 20 times or 30 times higher than what we want now. So it is just not possible to use these kinds of engines today, because the emission norms have become so strict that 80s engines would be something like 20, 30 times more than what we want. So the technology has completely changed. So I'll stop at this point by saying that we cannot have a sweet point where you can have all the emissions low, and the only solution is going slightly lean. And if you go slightly lean, maybe all the emissions are low, but not low enough. So for two-wheelers, actually what they are doing is they are going lean. Almost all the two-wheelers in India, two-wheeler norms are different from four-wheeler norms. Two-wheeler norms are a bit relaxed. Two-wheeler norms are going lean. Four-wheeler norms So we'll stop here, and from this point we'll take off tomorrow to see how the engine is controlled.
Thank you, sir.
So tomorrow we'll start, we'll continue with this session at 9:30 in the morning. Thank you, everybody.